Well, good morning, everyone. It's good to see you. Did you all skate in here okay, or hop on your snowmobiles and get here? But it's good to see you, and I appreciate you being here. And so we're going to start off with some singing. You all warmed up? Yeah, now. Well, let's stand and sing.
Small group, so sing out this morning.
There were walls of tears by the cross you came, broke them down. You broke them down. There were chains around us. By your grace we are. You called me out of the grave, you called me into the light, you called my name and then my heart came alive. Your love is greater, your love is stronger, your love awakens, awakens, awakens me. Your love is greater, your love is stronger, your love awakens, awakens, awakens. All the dead are coming back to life, come back to life. Hear the sun awaken, all creation singing, we're alive, 'cause you're alive. You called me out of the grave, you called me into the light, you called my name and then my heart came alive. Your love is great.
Amazing is your
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we come in here today to sing because we're grateful. We're humbled for your goodness and your interaction in our life. And so, Lord, we come in here to praise you. So, Lord, I just pray that you're in everything we do today, everything that we sing, everything we pray, everything that we hear. Your word, Lord, let it just resonate deep within our soul. And so that when we walk out of here, we're stronger, we're more in love with you today, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. I want to invite you to look over the prayer concerns that are listed in your bulletin. I do have a few that I want to give you. The first of which is Gilbert Houck. Gilbert has been in the nursing home and he fell and broke his hip. And so we need to pray for Gilbert. Also, we need to pray for Sharon Thomas. Sharon loves to come and be here with us, but she has been staying at home and they have cattle, and a cow got the best of her, and she ended up hurting her shoulder and actually breaking her shoulder. But she said the good news was that the ball and socket is still in place, and so it should be better healing that way. And then I just want to remind you, Pastor Dave got moved into hospice, and so They had found a mass on his liver, and so we need to pray for him. And so, and we'll try to get his room number and address to be able to send him cards. And so we'll get that in the next week or so. So, but keep praying for Pastor Dave and for Winnie and the boys and their family. So, yeah, during that difficult time. Yeah.
We're trying to get him set up with an iPad and using the Facebook Messenger, the video chat feature that's on that. That seems to be the most straightforward and kind of easiest thing for him. So hopefully over the next, you know, few days, you know, you might notice your friends with him that he's online, you know, checking, you know, don't be afraid to check in on him, give him a call and see what he's up to and just chat him for a few minutes.
Yeah.
He's got his phone with him too, so his cell phone, so he can make some calls and different things. So get settled in.
Sounds good. Yeah, so if you want to get a hold of him, you can still call him or reach out to him with Facebook Messenger and just let him know you're praying for him and thinking about him, and I'm sure he'll appreciate any contact he can get.
We did open all of his cards that were sent to him. We really enjoyed seeing those.
Yeah.
We really appreciated that.
Well, good. Good. Any other names we can add to the list?
We want to put her on there. She's looking at another surgery in February, so.
Okay.
And probably more difficult recovery, so.
Okay. So pray for Sarah Coffin, and she's having another shoulder surgery. She liked the first one so much that she's having another one. We'll pray for her. Any other prayer concerns? No? Okay. Well, let's go before the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, Lord, I just begin by giving you the names that were spoken today. Lord, for Gilbert and Sharon and Sarah, Lord, I just pray that you provide the healing that they need. Whether it's their hip or shoulder, Lord, just lay your hand upon it and heal it, Lord. We know that you're the great physician. And so, Lord, we pray for your healing touch. And, Lord, for Pastor Dave, Lord, we love him so very much. And we're so thankful for the ministry he had here. And, Lord, we just pray that you keep giving him comfort and peace. And Lord, I just pray that you be with him. And if it's your will to strengthen and heal him, so be it. But Lord, if it's your will that the ultimate healing will come, Lord, then prepare him and prepare his family for that. But Lord, we give him into your hands and your care. And so Lord, be with him. And Lord, we have all of these names on the list, and Lord, our heart is with them, and we just ask that you move powerfully through each one and through their life, and give them exactly what they need, Lord, and Lord, just again, move through their life, and Lord, let them know that it's from you. And so, Lord, we just give you all of these names. And, Lord, if there's something we can do and be an answer to prayer, put that on our heart as well. So this we ask in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Well, at this time, if you have your tithes and offerings, you can take them back to the box there. And at the same time, I'm going to invite the children to go to the back. They'll meet Michelle back there. I thought all the children were taking their tithes and offerings back there. Some are.
I think we have more children than adults today.
Yeah, we should do a count.
I do.
Yeah. Well, let me pray a blessing on the children and on Michelle. Heavenly Father, Lord, I thank you for all the children, and I ask that you bless their time here, keep them safe, and draw them close to you. Let them feel your presence. And Lord, we pray for Michelle, give her an extra ounce of patience and strength, and the Lord be with her as she ministers to the children. All this in Jesus' name, amen. And while they're heading upstairs, I want to invite you to turn to Luke chapter 22. I'm going to read from Luke 22, 14 through 23. This is going to be a passage maybe you're familiar with. Mine's entitled The Lord's Supper. And this is what Luke wrote. When the hour had come, he reclined at the table, and the apostles with him. And he said to them, I've earnestly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I say to you, I shall never again eat it until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God. And when he had taken a cup and given thanks, he said, take this and share it among yourselves. For I say to you, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine from now on until the kingdom of God comes. And when he had taken some of the bread and given thanks, he broke it and gave it to them, saying, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And in the same way, he took the cup, and after they had eaten, saying, this cup which is poured out for you is the new covenant in my blood. But behold, the hand of the one betraying me is with mine on the table. For indeed, the Son of Man is going as it has been determined. But woe to that man by whom he is betrayed. And they began to discuss among themselves which one of them it might be who is going to do this thing. That's God's word for us today. So we're continuing on in our series, and I kind of changed the order like I had mentioned before. And so last week's sermon actually happened before this week's sermon, or after this week's message, I mean. And so we are looking at the Lord's Supper, and when he instituted the Lord's Supper for each one of us. I want to start today with, I first played this video and used this illustration back in 2012. That was a long, long time ago, in a message that I had shared. And Tony, if you want to play the video, maybe start out with some sound for about maybe 15 seconds and then cut the sound out of it. And so what you're going to see playing behind me is this was taking place in the metro at in Washington, D.C. at the metro station. And it happened back in 2007, and it was commissioned by the Washington Post. And so the Washington Post posted this player here playing in the metro station, and he just simply played the violin for 43 straight minutes. And they were curious at how many people would stop and notice this exquisite violin player. And here's what they found out. Most people just moved on. One person slowed his pace and just kind of listened, but he kept on going. At this point, 63 people passed by, and at the four-minute mark, the first dollar was dropped into his till. A woman threw money in the hat without stopping, but she continued to walk. A little while later, a young man stopped and paused and leaned up against the wall and to listen to what he was playing. And he was moved by the sound. They interviewed him a little while later. He was just so moved by the sound that he stopped and he wanted to hear more. One other thing they noticed was kids were often attracted to listen to him, and they wanted to go drop money in or just to pause and listen. But every single time, the parent kind of drug him or her to move on quickly. Now, near the end, there was a man by the name of John Piccarello. He heard the music and it stopped him. You see, he located the source of the sound and moved to a safe distance away on the other side of the building. And he stands near this bustling lotto line. And he stands in amazement for 9 straight minutes. And then he humbly walks over and drops $5 in his hat, understanding that he had heard something worth more than just $5. And when they interviewed him later, he said that he had studied violin and he knew the sounds of a typical violin. And he said that wasn't typical. And so he kept walking and didn't say a word to the violinist. The only person that recognized the violinist was a woman by the name of Stacy Furukawa. And she had attended a free concert at the Library of Congress. And she recognized this man as the one who played there that night. And so she dropped in $20 into the till. Now, the musician continued to play for all of those 43 minutes, even though people were just passing by, ignoring him. Only 7 people stopped and listened. Out of thousands, 7 stopped to hear. About 20 gave money, but continued to walk at their normal pace. And he collected a total of $32. You know, that's not bad, $32 for 43 minutes. But no one knew this, but the violinist's name is Joshua Bell. Joshua Bell was considered renowned while he was still a teenager. And now he is considered a virtuoso worldwide. He is highly sought after. He's 39 years old now. And he was playing 6 pieces that were some of the most intricately written pieces of music. His violin, by the way, estimated worth of $3.5 million. Those people walked by and had no idea that little piece of wood was worth $3.5 million. He only plays a certain type of violin from the 1700s. He says makes the best sound. And so that's what he plays. Well, he played the week before at Boston Stately Symphony Hall. And merely pretty good seats went for $100 a piece. 2 weeks later at the Music Center at the Strathmore, he would play to a standing room audience that would even muffle their cough and wait until a pause or a break to do it, to not disturb him. But that particular Friday in January, Joshua Bell was simply just another person playing, competing for the attention of all those people walking by. And so the Washington Post wrote this article, Pearls Before Breakfast, examining what was happening in this video and how people didn't recognize greatness when it was set out of context, right? And it makes me wonder, how often do we miss greatness? I know there's been older people that I've talked to. And one guy in Minnesota I was talking to, and he had written a lot of famous jingles that were on the TV from my childhood. He's the one who wrote them. And I'm like, whoa, that's crazy. Another guy, I found out why he walked with a limp was because in World War II, when he was jumping out of a plane as a paratrooper, his pack got caught just as his plane was being shot down. And just before it reached the ground, his chute deployed and saved his life. Pretty incredible stories right in front of us, right? And sometimes we don't even know it. And I think about as Jesus insisted on getting together with his disciples for this Passover meal. The Bible tells that Jesus was excited to be celebrating it with them? How many of them stopped to ever pause to realize that greatness was right in front of them? That Jesus Christ, the Messiah, was right in front of them. Now, Peter recognized, he said, Lord, you are the Christ. But did he truly take it to heart? And so what do we do each and every day when we come to church? Are we expecting to meet God here? Or are we just doing it because that's what we're supposed to do? We walk in the doors, walk out the doors, without having stopped to pause that the creator of the universe wants to have a relationship with us, that he loves us. And do we, when we take communion, do we pause and do what we're told in remembering him when we do it? So our key question today is simply this. Why do we take communion? I like to preach at least once a year on some of the things that are tenets of our faith, right? And communion is one of those things that is a tenet of our faith. And I didn't realize how big of a deal communion was to me until I attended a church that really made light of communion. Basically, you took it as you walked out the door. Nothing was said about it, and that disturbed me greatly. So our key idea is this. Jesus demonstrated it and then commanded us to do it. You see, it's considered a sacrament in the church. Have you heard that word? Sacrament. Baptism is a sacrament. How did we decide what a sacrament was? How did the church decide a long time ago? It boils down to these two things. Jesus demonstrated it and then he commanded us to do it. And so, baptism and communion. Our key scripture, and he took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, gave it to them, saying, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after the supper, he took the cup, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you. And so, in this passage that we are looking at today. I'm in Luke 22. And Jesus had told the disciples, go on into town and you're going to find things prepared for us. There's going to be a spot in an upper room big enough for all of us, a table that we can sit on one side and pose for a picture. I'll show you that picture later and talk about it. But no, they sat around the table and they were celebrating Passover, but it was all set up. And so it's important to understand, why were they celebrating? Why did Jesus insist on celebrating this Passover? And so if we go back to the original Passover, it takes us to Exodus 12. And in Exodus 12, at this point, Moses had gone back into Egypt. The Israelites had been slaves. And Moses said, let my people go. And the Pharaoh would say, no, I'm not going to. And so God, through Moses, enacted one plague after another. Now, each plague was defeating a god of Egypt. So then it gets to 9 plagues, and they're getting ready for the 10th. And God says to them, this is what you're to do. You're to kill a Passover lamb. Your lamb shall be an unblemished male, 1 year old. Kill it at twilight. And this sounds gruesome, doesn't it? Take some blood and put it on the 2 doorposts and on the lintel of the houses in which they eat it. They shall eat the flesh that same night. You roast it with fire, and they shall eat it with unleavened bread and bitter herbs. Do not eat it raw or boiled at all with water, but roasted with fire. both its head and its legs, along with its entrails. And you shall not leave any of it over until morning, but whatever's left of it, you shall burn with fire. And then you shall eat in this manner, with your loins girded, your sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hand. You shall eat it in haste. It's the Lord's Passover. They were to eat this meal, getting ready to bolt. They were going to eat this meal, and then the Lord would pass over, and they were going to leave shortly thereafter. And so the blood will be a sign for you on the houses where you live. When I see the blood, I will pass over you, and no plague will befall you to destroy you when I strike the land of Egypt. And so the Lord had them paint the blood over the doorpost, and then he was going to pass over any house with that marking. Now the houses that did not have that marking, he was going to kill their firstborn. This is significant for numerous reasons. The first reason is that it was Pharaoh who killed their babies first. The second reason is it was the firstborn of Pharaoh was considered a god. And so he was saying, Pharaoh, if you think you're more powerful than my God, then we'll put this to the test. And so when Pharaoh's oldest son died, it showed that God was more powerful than Pharaoh. And so the Passover, the Lord passed over those houses. He saved them. And when Pharaoh saw all this happen, he said, rise up, get out from among my people. Both you and the sons of Israel, go worship the Lord as you have said. Take both your flocks and your herds as you have said, and go and bless me also. He was saying, get out of here. I've had enough. And so it was through that Passover was enacted. And it was commanded to them to celebrate it. They said, now this day will be a memorial to you. You shall celebrate it as a feast to the Lord. And so to this very day, Jewish people have Passover. And it's around Easter time. And we actually had a group come in and lead a Passover Seder, a meal for us, about maybe 5 or 6 years ago. And it's incredibly meaningful. And so here, they still celebrate it today. And so it was done as a thankfulness for not only the Lord giving them, passing over them, but also for leading them out of slavery and into freedom. So that's what they were celebrating. They were part of that tradition, remembering the great Passover. And so in verse 14, what I had read, when the hour had come, remember Jesus always said, now the hour is not yet at hand. Well, now he says, the hour is at hand. The hour is here. And then he said, it's recorded, he reclined at the table. That was the only meal that they reclined. Some of us eat reclined at our house, right? But this was unique, sitting at the dinner table, reclined back. That was something that they did only during Passover. And the apostles were with him, and he said to them, I've earnestly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. He wanted to be there with them. They were clueless to the whole thing of what was about to come. This was his passion week, his passion. He was getting ready to die for us. He knew it. They didn't. And they were missing it right in front of their eyes. He says, for I say to you, I shall never eat it again until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God. He was looking forward. And when he had taken a cup and given thanks, he said, take this and share it among yourselves. For I say to you, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine now until the kingdom of God comes. And so there, every meal, every Passover meal had several cups that you would drink from. And one of those cups, it's believed, was saved for the coming Messiah. So year after year after year after year, that cup was never, ever touched. And Jesus changes the script of the typical Passover Seder over the meal, and he takes that cup, and that's the one he drinks from. And when he had taken some bread and given thanks, he broke it and gave it to them, saying, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." I just wonder what the disciples, when they heard that, what were they thinking? What are you talking about? This is your body. And why would we remember? You're right here. They certainly got it after the end of the next week. And in the same way, he took the cup after they had eaten, saying, "This cup, which is poured out for you, is the new covenant in my blood." Remember, the old covenant was that as you sinned, then you would have to atone for your sins by the sacrificial system. You would have to bring in an animal to sacrifice, and your sins would be placed on that. I don't know about you, but I'm so glad God did away with that. Instead, and so all that did was reveal the need for an atonement for our sin. It didn't cleanse them of anything. And so now, Jesus is saying, "I'm instituting a new covenant," right then, right there. He is now, it's his blood, not the Passover lamb, but it's his blood. He is the new Passover lamb once and for all. His sins, or our sins, are atoned by his death, not the death of animals. And so it's our covenant in Christ. "But behold, the hand of the one betraying me is with mine on this table. For indeed the Son of Man is going, and it has been determined. But woe to that man by whom he's betrayed." Judas was going to betray him. And they began to discuss among themselves which one of them it might be to those who's going to do this thing. And then there's one other passage that I just want to briefly talk about that has to do with the Lord's Supper. And this is, Paul is talking and teaching, and he's been hearing things about the church of Corinth. And the church of Corinth had gotten to be almost perverse with their way of taking communion. One is, there was a rumor floating around that it was... that they were cannibalists, that they were actually eating and drinking blood and flesh. That's kind of gross. But the second thing is, they would actually hold what was called, they called them love feasts. And it started out just as a communion festival and feast, but then it turned into other things that were inappropriate. And he was telling them, you need to take communion seriously. And so he said, "For as often as you eat of this bread and drink of the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." So one of the things you do when you take it is you proclaim his death. "And therefore, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner shall be guilty of the body and the blood of the Lord." So you're saying in this context, you better be taking it in a worthy manner. Know what you're doing. When parents ask me, when do I know when kids can take communion? And I always say, when they can do it and understand what they're doing. Know why you're taking it, be able to confess your sins, and then you're ready to take it. Now, it says here, it also goes on to define a little bit more. It says, "But a man must examine himself, and in so doing, He is to eat of the bread and drink of the cup. So it's saying to examine yourself before you take it. That's the context in which he was talking about. So do a self-reflection. So all of this leads us to a teaching on communion. And so I just want to read, and I have this slide on what our bylaws, what our beliefs are. And so this is straight from that. We wrote, we believe in sharing together in the observation of the Lord's Supper, communion. We teach that scriptural requirements for partaking the articles, the bread representing the body of Christ and the cup representing his blood shed for our redemption, is first to honestly examine ourselves and repent of any and all sin. This self-examination must include asking the Lord Jesus to reveal to us any unchristlike behavior, any unforgiveness, or any unresolved matter that would disqualify us from partaking of the communion service. After self-examination, all believers are invited to share together, remembering that which Jesus endured and submitted himself so that we could be forgiven for our sins. That's very well written, very well put, very concise in telling us that we need to look within ourselves, just like Paul wrote. So a quick look at the Passover and the Lord's Supper, comparing the two. The Passover, God remembered his covenant. God had remembered his covenant, and in the Lord's Supper, he enacted the new covenant. The second thing is, in the Passover, they were in slavery in Egypt, and in the Lord's Supper, we were in slavery to sin. In the Passover, a deliverance from the Egyptians, and in the Lord's Supper, a forgiveness of our sins, deliverance from sin. In the Passover, there was the blood of the Passover lamb smeared over the doorpost. And in the Lord's Supper, it's the blood of Christ, the ultimate Passover lamb. In the Passover, they interpreted the elements. And in the Lord's Supper, Jesus taught them about the elements. And in the Passover, there was a call for continual celebration. And in the Lord's Supper, again, Jesus told us, this do in remembrance of me. Some more things. A lesson is there were four words of institution in the Lord's Supper. If you go to just about any church, you'll hear these words of institution discussed. First is Jesus said, this is my body. That's so critical, right? Because that's why we're doing it. We're remembering that Jesus' body was broken for each one of us. And then he said, this do in remembrance of me. When we come to communion, we remember him. And then he said, this is my blood of the covenant poured out for many. So his body was broken. His blood was shed for us. It was his blood over our doorpost so that the Lord would pass over and we could have eternal life. And then he said, until the kingdom of God, we keep taking it until he comes back. And he wasn't going to drink of the vine until he did it in the kingdom of God. And so someday we'll meet up with him again. So how now shall I live? First, take communion seriously. And I mean that by come prepared. When you take it, understand what you're doing. The second thing is examine yourself. Even before you come, you can come prepared and be ready to take communion. Third, repent and ask for forgiveness. And we know that God is quick to forgive. I was always taught communion was a means of grace, a time that God wanted to come in and pour his forgiveness on you. A specific time to make that happen. I've known people that have come to Christ while taking communion that God moved in their life. That's a means of grace. And then receive the truth and grace. Truth in that sometimes we have to hear what we don't want to hear. Things that divide us and God. And grace in that God will forgive. And then I want to encourage you, based on all of that, to receive, to take communion. In the Gospels, not all of them say it, but some say to take communion. I think about receiving, but it was a direct statement, take it. Jesus was imploring them to take it. So before we take communion, I want to show you this picture. So I've told you the story of when I was getting my bachelor's degree, I had one class that I had to take that I forgot to take, and it was a humanities class, and I'm like, ugh, humanities. It was kind of my least favorite subject area. And I looked, and there was art appreciation, and I thought, that's interesting. So I emailed the professor, and I say, do I have to do art? Like, I want a good grade. And if I have to do art, then I'm not going to do well in the class. And he said, oh, you'll have one minor project to do. But in this, at this Christian college, we learned about art, and I learned to appreciate it. It actually became legitimately one of my favorite classes. And some of the early paintings were commissioned by the church. The church were the ones that had the money to pay the artists to make these masterpieces. And so one of my favorites is Leonardo da Vinci. Da Vinci made contributions to all areas of society. He was ingenious. He had inventions and devices that he had drawn out. He understood the human body and human anatomy. He made advances in biology. And so he had all of these different things. But as you know, he also painted a lot for the church. And so he painted a painting that we know as the Last Supper, which I never like calling it the Last Supper because we know that Jesus rose again and lives forever. And so it wasn't his Last Supper, right? But Da Vinci painted this on a monastery wall. He was commissioned to paint this painting. And you notice the door? It was painted actually above a door in this monastery. And you look at this painting, and we've all seen it. We've actually had tapestries in this church made from it or of it. And it's an interesting thing because Da Vinci was trying to capture that exact moment, a literal snapshot of when the disciples found out that one of them was going to betray him. And so forth from the left is Judas kind of clutching on to the sack of money. And the rest of them, their expressions are kind of unique. And so he tried to portray, and he really prayed through and tried to capture each one. Now, I don't know what Da Vinci's faith background was, even if he had one. But some of his paintings were certainly divinely inspired. And he used several things that were interesting to me. But one of the things that he did, and to me, it was very, very meaningful. Every time I see this picture, I see it. But if you follow all of the lines, he used something called vanishing point. Vanishing point is creating kind of a 3D look to the picture. And so there in that slide, I followed all of the lines. And even some of the disciples had lines. And if you follow them, what he wanted you to understand was the main point of this whole chaos that was going on in this picture was Jesus Christ. He purposely put the vanishing point just above Jesus' head so that your eyes naturally go straight to him. Yeah, you may look around the picture, but you understand that it's going straight to Christ. All in the Lord's Supper. This do in remembrance of me. We look at the painting and we can't help but notice that Christ is the central figure. Right above the doorway. I can imagine everybody that went down looked up and understood that Christ is the key and the core when we take communion. So today, when we take communion, we certainly do it in remembrance of him. We remember that Jesus died on the cross at the hands of sinful men, rose 3 days later, triumphing over sin and death. It was his body broken and his blood shed for each one of us. And so when we do it in remembrance of him. And I always talk about this dichotomy, the two things that we think about. On one hand, we're thankful. We're excited. It's a celebration that Jesus forgave us of our sins. Amen? But we also know that it came at a great cost. The greatest teacher, the greatest healer that ever lived, died for us. He gave everything he had. A celebration and a memorial, all wrapped up into one. And so today, when we take communion, we remember why he did what he did. It was for our sins, our faults, our failures, and that he died for our forgiveness and our freedom. And so before you take the elements, I just implore you, look within yourself and say, Lord, I'm examining myself. What do I need to give to you? Lord, forgive me of my sins. And this I know, you'll be quick to forgive and you'll feel his grace and his mercy above everything. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, bless the cup and bless the bread so that when we take it, we remember what Christ did for us. Lord, we know that it did come at a cost, and so we remember our sins. Lord, I pray that you take each one from us and forgive us. Pour your forgiveness on everyone here, your grace and your mercy. In Jesus' name, amen. Our table's open to any believer, anyone who's actively seeking Jesus. Doesn't mean you have it all figured out or that you've know all what Scripture has to say, but merely you're looking and you're seeking to find Christ. We move the elements to the back so that it opens up the altar. You can take the cup and the bread and either bring it to the altar and take it at the altar, or you can take it back to your seat whenever you're ready, and you can take communion there. It's up to you, but won't you come? Take my life. it's my prayer that God does meet you in those elements. It's a time that's set aside just for you to meet him. And so it's a special time. And sometimes we expect all of these great feelings to come from it, but it doesn't always happen that way. Sometimes it feels ordinary, but the important thing is to not just walk by it without stopping to appreciate it. Like the violinist in the metro in DC. It's important for us to remember why he did what he did. I want to invite the band to come up and we'll sing our hymn of invitation. And if you need prayer, if you come walked in here with a burden or something on your heart, please don't walk out of here with that burden. Let me pray with you. We'll stand and let's sing. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you and we praise you. Lord, we remember communion. Lord, we do it certainly in celebration and in remembrance of what Jesus has done for us. And so, Lord, I just pray that each one of us may walk out of here and live our life in the victory that was won on Calvary. Lord, I pray that each one of us may live for you each and every day. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, I have some announcements for you. The first of which, if you haven't done so and you are interested in choosing your one word for the year, Sheila has designed this. This happens to be, oh no, this isn't mine.
Is it?
It looks like this. So our church word for the year is going to be revive. Revive. And this has your word within the word revive. And so my word is time. And so it's a word cloud that forms revive out of your word. That makes sense? And so if you give your word to her, and you can immediately out to the left, there's kind of a welcome area. And there's a fishbowl. You can write your word down. And Sheila will make one of these for you. And she's going to do this next week. So if you're interested in receiving one of these, just let us know. It's always kind of a fun thing to do. The next thing I want to mention is if you're interested in singing a special or reading scripture, we like to have different faces involved in the service, and so you can sign up out in the foyer. Also, our children's ministry, JAM, and our middle school ministry, BLAST, as well as our high school ministry, CIA, there's information there. We always start with a meal and then go on to our lessons. And so JAM and BLAST starts at 6 and with the meal, and high school starts at 6:30. So also one more thing, Sunday school is started back up, and so you can find information on the different classes there as well. If you're part of Don Brain's, just note that he'll be back next week for his class.
Hey, Mark, I just want to say thank you to Tony for signing up for 56 times of singing for first and second service.
Oh, Tony signed up 56 times for singing?
I'm not sure he's aware of that.
Tony, I'm really looking forward to that. Are you country or rap or whatever?
Rap.
Oh, gosh. There's always one in the bunch, isn't there? Oh, gosh. No, but if you're interested, do sign up for that. Well, let's sing our closing song.
Take my life and let it be all for you.